Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's truly my pleasure to present to you today with an overview of the evolving role of novel and next generation therapy in the management of myeloma as part of our patient weekend of information derived not only from this year's most recent ASH meeting in 2020, but also from earlier meetings in 2020, and give you a nice update looking to the future. My intent with this comprehensive discussion clinically is to complement some of the talks you've heard already, and most importantly, to complement Ken's talk by building on some of the themes that he's touched on and providing you with a little more detail in that regard. First and foremost, however, I want to thank very much the organizers for putting together our seminar, which has always been a Christmas landmark in years before. This time, of course, we've had to stage it in January to reflect last year's work. But just to wish everyone a very happy and healthy new year, recognizing that the last year has been of unprecedented challenge as we face both the challenges in the country generally and at the same time, of course, the real challenge of COVID-19, which is ongoing. I especially want to acknowledge the support of my colleagues in our seminar, and most importantly, of course, Andy and the technical team here at Dana-Farber, as well as our supporters. And above all, thank you to you for being part of our conversation today, and we hope you'll find the information from our presentations useful. Because the very good news in myeloma is that despite the challenges of COVID-19, our research has continued at pace, and I'm particularly pleased to report to you that here at Dana-Farber, our group has been able to continue its productivity, and which is an incredible testament to our team, and most importantly, our research coordination team and our research nursing, as well as our nursing team on Y7, as well as all those involved, and not least of which, of course, my fellow physician colleagues. In that capacity, we've actually been as active in the research program in 2020 as we were in 2019, in fact, exceeding that by some metrics, which I think is real testimony to the quality of work we're doing. In that same spirit, it's amazing that in 2020, FDA approvals were numerous for myeloma, and we were actually involved not only in the approval of isatuximab, also in the approval of daratumumab subcutaneously administered, belantamab mafodotin in the summer, and then most recently in the combination of selinexor, bortezomib and dexamethasone as part of the Boston study, which I'll touch on in a moment. And then we're very much hoping in the next month or so to be able to share with you the accelerated approval of melflufen. So it's been really a remarkably productive time. So with that in mind, I want to start now by discussing with you some current status and future directions for new treatments. In terms of key targets in myeloma as we think to 2021, I think it's very important to share with you that as we think biologically of this, the targeting and overcoming of mutations is central. There is therefore a critical role of combination and continuous therapy as part of that. And as Ken talked about, there is an evolving position and timing of transplant. We're recognizing that that particular modality in our treatment has been very important for younger patients for many decades. But as we move into the new millennia, and especially into the 2020s, the timing of transplant is clearly something that has become an area of active research and something that for an increasing subset of patients we believe can be kept in reserve. And then in terms of future directions, obviously a major underpinning of the biology of myeloma is targeting excess protein production by its very nature, and targeting protein degradation has become and continues to be a pillar of our therapeutic platforms. But in that same context, immune suppression has become an absolutely central tenet to what we do, and we'll talk more about that as we go forward. Now, I just share this slide because I think a picture speaks a thousand words. Myeloma is truly a highly complex disease at diagnosis and at relapse, not only due to the underlying mutational thrust of the genetics of the cancer itself, but also to what we call clonal evolution. The good news is that we have treatments to match this, and I'll talk a lot more about this in a moment. I think another concept is that treating multiple myeloma should be considered truly a marathon and not a sprint. And what I mean by that is, as prognosis has dramatically improved, and it's wonderful to be with you today in 2021, looking to a future where literally we've added and doubled median survival over the last 20 years, at least, with a horizon that's looking to 10 to 15 year median survivals if we continue to see the progress that we've seen to date, recognizing that 20 years ago, median survival was no better than 2 to 3 on average, with 3 to 5 if you were young, healthy, and able to undergo a transplant. Now, as I mentioned, these have at least been doubled, tripled, and even arguably in an increasing subset of patients, quadrupled. So as you think of this, it's important then to recognize that the treatment of myeloma has to be thought of strategically as a long distance run, as it were, versus a sprint. What I mean by that is, as we think about therapeutic choices early in the disease, we must also recognize their importance later and the impact they may have. Now, to meet the challenge of the numerous treatment options that we need to meet the complexity of myeloma, the good news is we have currently 12 approved novel agents in myeloma as of now, with more shortly to come. And obviously, as I mentioned to you already, we had the approval of belantamab mafodotin in the summer of last year, together with isatuximab earlier in the year, as well as a variety of indications for various combinations. Now, the excitement here is then how do we put these all together and how do we optimize these platforms for treating our patients? Another point is that in the upfront treatment of myeloma, I'm showing here graphically a variety of combination strategies that used to be mainstays of therapy even just a decade ago or even 5 years ago. And now and in the future, you can see how these quadruplets are now starting to gain real traction. And we'll spend a bit of time on the implications of this in a moment. Now, the basis of triplet therapy was really first established almost 15 years ago. And as you can see here, as one representative example, the particular platform of lenalidomide and bortezomib was firmly established in the upfront setting, certainly, and by a number of pivotal single-arm clinical trials. And I want to especially acknowledge the patients and families who participated, because by so doing, we were able not only to enhance their clinical outcome dramatically, but at the same time, demonstrate critically for patients and providers the tenet that 3 drugs are clearly better than 2 going forward, and that the addition of chemotherapy to this platform, interestingly, in these experiences, was helpful in some patients, but not in all. Now, when I say 3 drugs are better than 2, the pivotal randomized data to support this comes from the so-called SWOG SO777 study led by my colleague Dr. Brian Drury and published a few years ago in The Lancet. And as you can see here, the RVD platform clearly outperforming the doublet, both for progression-free and overall survival relatively quickly. The good news is that you can adapt RVD to make it less intensive, and the so-called RVD-like platform has become particularly attractive to our older patients and for those patients interested in a more convenient approach, and you don't appear to lose efficacy. The response rates are dramatic and the duration of response is maintained, whereas tolerability is actually very favorable. In that same spirit, in older patients, there are a number of other combinations, such as lenalidomide and dexamethasone with daratumumab, that have been FDA approved, and these are important advances, obviously. In the interest of time, though, I'm going to focus more on triplets and their role in younger patients, simply to give you an idea of the directions in which we're going. Now, one particularly important platform has been that of carfilzomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone, so-called KRD. And this was compared in the pivotal Endurance study, a phase 3 trial involving over 1,000 patients and presented at ASCO as a plenary session this last year, to compare the results of KRD versus RVD, and what did that in factually show. This was also published in The Lancet last year as well. Well, remarkably, what we showed was, despite the fact that there was a feeling that KRD would be more powerful than RVD, and as you can see, the RVD is the red line here, the KRD is the blue line, actually that did not turn out to be the case. So sometimes the more powerful platform may not be actually better than the platform that performs very well but is arguably better tolerated, where in this case RVD, whilst there was neuropathy, was not associated with the cardiovascular, vascular, thromboembolic, pulmonary and renal type challenges that were seen in a small but significant number of patients receiving KRD. The point simply here is that less may be more, and that in the context of certain settings, the use of well-tolerated regimens is pivotal as we think about treating the disease strategically. That being said, of course, KRD nonetheless for younger, healthier patients who are not challenged by vascular risk is a particularly potent and active platform, and in patients with so-called high-risk disease, the KRD platform may be particularly relevant. Now, how then does this all pan into transplant? Well, as many of you are aware, we've been partnered with our French colleagues, and Dr. Anderson, Ken spoke about this with you in his presentation as well, to better understand the positioning of transplant in the era of novel agents. It's been a privilege to work with our French partners and provided us with the real strength of numbers and quality and information to really help guide treatment in the future. What happened in our trial was the following. We looked at the RVD platform with early transplant versus late, and in the French study, lenalidomide was given for 1 year only, and fortunately in the US study, we were able to give this until progression. The important point about why it was given for only 1 year was really a regulatory one, driven by the French authorities. However, this did allow us to be able to compare len for 1 year versus len until progression. Now, the good news is that the French study is fully enrolled, and we have mature data I'm going to show to you in a moment. The exciting news for the US study, the so-called determination trial, we enrolled 720 patients to this. Our French partners enrolled 700. We still cannot report to you the outcome of the determination trial. We started in 2010. It's now obviously 2021. We are hoping we'll have information for you. And the reason that's such good news is it means that both cohorts of patients are doing very well, and it tells you that early transplant versus late is certainly not showing an early signal in favor of one versus the other. And we do believe that the lenalidomide maintenance that is given until progression is really impacting on this. And I'll come back to that in a moment. What I also wanted to share is that in this study, we're also learning a lot about how to use MRD, and that I've summarized in the graphic here. Now, what do we know so far about this early versus late transplant experience? Well, I want to share with you that our French partners have published a couple of years ago, and in fact we were all part of the publications, part of the collaborative group, that if you looked at progression-free survival with early transplant versus late, importantly, progression-free survival was better if you went with an early transplant, with a difference of around 14 months. However, there was absolutely no difference in survival, as you can see from these curves. Now, this was critically updated by long-term follow-up analysis at ASH, and this was presented by my colleague, Dr. Aurore Perot. And Aurore, she did a wonderful job of showing this with median follow-up at 8 years now. She was able to show that median survival has not been reached, which is very good news, and that 8-year survival was almost identical in both arms, with 60.2% for the RVD alone arm versus 62% for the RVD followed by transplant early. And what she also showed was that median follow-up and indeed MRD negativity were very important aspects of assessing clinical benefit. And MRD negativity was a strong predictor of outcome. Now, I want to show this to you graphically because I always think these things are a little bit easier to appreciate in the form of graphs. But what you can see on the left here is actually what we call the progression-free survival analysis, comparing transplant early versus late. And you can see actually with mature follow-up, the progression-free survival actually is not as big as it was early. It was around 14 months previously. It's now about 12. But what's critical to note is the 8-year survival is identical. There is absolutely no difference. And as I mentioned, MRD negativity does appear to matter whether you have a transplant or you don't. Now, the importance of MRD is worth a mention, because I know Ken went into this in detail. I simply want to re-emphasize it. I think MRD negativity as a research tool is particularly valuable. In clinical practice, we're learning how best to use this. But I think it's important to share with you that MRD negativity can be a very important guide as we adapt and develop our combination approaches. So, for example, in the context of our French work, we identified that MRD negativity means different things in different settings. For example, if you're 414 translocated, which is your disease is 414 translocated, you've got perhaps a higher chance of MRD negativity. But unfortunately, if you're deletion 17p, enriched in terms of the myeloma, that's more difficult to get to MRD negative status. And this does appear to be relevant to how patients do in the long term. So you can see how we can use this tool potentially to tailor therapy further. But very importantly, how to use it in real time is critical, because what we're learning is that MRD is dynamic, and that in fact, as you maintain patients for longer, their MRD negativity can improve even with simple maintenance. And that's a critical takeaway message that we'll come to. Another important point in the context of transplant early versus late is quality of life. It's absolutely essential, and it's something I think that we're increasingly realizing in our clinical trials is absolutely vital in the context of assessing the benefit of therapy. And the quality of life assessment in the French study was first presented at the ASH meeting in 2018 as an oral session, and was actually just published in Leukemia and Lymphoma last year. And what you can see here is that, in fact, whilst the quality of life in both RVD NRVD plus transplant arms improves over time, you can see from this graphic that if you undergo a transplant, the global measures of quality of life drop dramatically across the transplant for about 3 to 4 months. Now, many of you who've been through transplant would say, well, that's fair enough, this makes complete sense. But having said that, it's basically also true that in that same context, the recovery obviously can vary from one patient to another. And in that same setting, we can see patients in whom the quality of life is impacted relatively modestly, but we can also see some patients in whom the impact of quality of life can be really quite substantial. What I think is a little bit sobering is that there is a drop of greater than 10 points seen overall, and this is randomized prospective information derived from over 700 patients. And what you can see here is that whilst it certainly does recover, there is a clinically meaningful difference for quality of life with transplant. So we have to say to ourselves, there is an impact on quality of life on the one hand, and on the other hand, we have to also say, at the moment, there is no survival benefit in the long term to early transplant versus keeping it in reserve. Then there is the question of long-term side effects. We have to be very careful about these. We do know that there is a long-term risk of secondary leukemia and myelodysplasia from exposure to high-dose melphalan. And what we've realized is that this is a longitudinal effect. It's not something that disappears after 5 years. It continues for a while. The good news is that the risk is low. The challenge, however, is that it is not something that disappears, as I mentioned, but can increase over time. So what it tells us is that we must think very carefully about whom we expose to high-dose melphalan and whom we don't, for a variety of reasons. Number one, that there could be this potential risk of secondary leukemia, albeit rare and small, but real. And at the same time, what we're also learning is that genotoxic chemotherapy like melphalan can also cause damage to the tumor cells, which it survives, but then critically when it comes back, the mutational burden is higher. Now, this is a whole genome sequencing image on one of our patients, and this is courtesy of my colleague Nikhil Munshi, and Nikhil very kindly provided this information to show a critical point. As you can see at diagnosis, this patient has over 5,000 mutations. At relapse, these go up, in fact, to over 12,000. So this is important because this patient did have high-dose therapy. So the question is, if you don't have high-dose therapy, what does the mutational burden look like? Well, very interestingly, in our French partner study, we have collaboratively looked at RVD versus RVD early transplant and looked at mutational burden. This was presented by our colleague Mehmet Samur as an oral session at ASH and attracted a great deal of attention because what it showed was that whilst the number of mutations at diagnosis seen in the patient studied in this subgroup analysis was similar, around 7,000, when you relapsed, if you hadn't had a transplant, you gained about 1,700 mutations, but if you had had a transplant, even though your disease was controlled for longer but then came back somewhat later, unfortunately, when it came back, on average, it was enriched for up to 5,700 mutations versus the 1,700 I mentioned before, and this was highly statistically significant. Now, what exactly the clinical implications of this are is not clear, but having said that, when you see a higher mutation rate going on, you have to say to yourself, well, this is something we have to be very careful about, because if we're basically gaining benefit in the short term but we'll pay a higher price in the long term, perhaps we need to think differently about how we approach this. So I think this is hypothesis generating but very important and underpins our fundamental research question of how best to tailor and position transplant, recognizing that for some patients it clearly is the best thing that can be done. Now, to emphasize that point, there was a wonderful presentation my colleague Francesca gave from the Italian group at the ASH meeting. I know Dr. Anderson touched on this earlier with you too, but this is a very ambitious study in which they looked at the KRD platform, and to cut a long story short, show that KRD is an induction regimen of choice when compared to carfilzomib and Cytoxan, and that it actually can mean that for a subset of patients you can definitely keep early transplant in reserve, but for others you may need it. Why this was so important was the following observation, that KRD transplant did improve progression-free survival, remembering we do need to await overall survival as a key marker, but the benefit of KRD transplant was apparent actually in all groups, not just simply high risk. So this was encouraging. So this clearly shows that subgroups benefit, particularly perhaps in high-risk patients. Now, what was very interesting is that maintenance in this setting, in this trial, was tailored. So some patients got carfilzomib and lenalidomide, some just got lenalidomide. And that's a very important point because we know that maintenance matters to outcome. So again, lots of information to come from this trial still, but this clearly still shows that there may be a benefit in some patients from the early use of transplant compared to late, but again, maturity of information will be crucial. Now similarly, at the ASCO meeting last year, there was important updates from the STAMINA trial. Now this was not a study in which transplant was kept in reserve. Everyone got a transplant. The question was, did they get a second one, which is pretty tough, or did they get some form of tailored maintenance, be it lenalidomide alone or RVD plus lenalidomide? The interesting question was the following. Was there a difference in progression-free and overall survival? Well, interestingly enough, no. If you got two transplants, or you got a transplant followed by RVD, or a transplant followed by straightforward maintenance, if you took all comers, it looked basically the same. No differences in outcomes. So that's, in a sense, good news, meaning that certainly if you approach something with the transplant and lenalidomide maintenance, that may be just fine for most patients. Adding the RVD might help some, but it's clear it doesn't do a great deal. And two transplants versus one didn't seem to add very much either overall. However, if you looked at high risk, the story was a little bit different. As you can see here, two transplants and the transplant plus RVD seemed to help higher risk patients. That means the genetics in these patients was particularly adverse. They might benefit from additional treatment. So again, a tailored approach making sense. And then finally, there was an analysis looking at maintenance discontinuation, and no surprises here, but there was clearly a benefit for those patients who continued on lenalidomide maintenance versus those who did not. The curves here are really quite striking. So I think that this tells us that maintenance really matters, which of course we already knew from different settings, but this was nice confirmatory information. And as we think about determination, the US study that I alluded to earlier, this will be absolutely essential because there we have maintenance until either the drugs are not tolerated and or the disease gets worse. And most of our patients have continued on maintenance throughout and they've done remarkably well in both arms. So again, the importance of maintenance being emphasized. Okay, so as I think on now, let's talk where we're going in terms of future directions. A critical future direction is that of adding antibodies to this platform. Now the question then becomes, where does transplant belong? Because if you've got the three drugs and then you add an antibody, what then happens? Well, before we get to that question, let's quickly move through the role of triplets plus an antibody in transplant. Very important paper that was presented in 2019 by my colleague Dr. Philippe Moreau and published in The Lancet at around the same time, clearly demonstrated that the addition of daratumumab, which is a fantastic, exciting CD38 targeting antibody, dramatically improved outcome in this study. And what you can see is that illustrated here, and what you, dramatically improved outcome. So, as I move to this next trial, I just want to show you that this was the outcome that was remarkably improved. This was the so-called Cassiopeia study. So again, not to confuse you with details, but what you can see here is that when you added daratumumab to VTD, it performed substantially better than the VTD alone, and that this translated into a substantial improvement in progression-free survival. Now the curve I want to bring to your attention here is the one at the top. And what you can see here is that the four-drug platform performed really well. The three-drug did okay, but not as well as the four, and this was reflected in these response rates that are illustrated over here. Now, what about RVD, recognizing that VTD is very much a European regimen, it's popular, but it has thalidomide, which is challenging and a somewhat older drug. Lenalidomide, of course, and Velcade and Dex remain our sort of a go-to triplet at the moment, and so when you add daratumumab to that, what do things look like? Well, this is our particular trial led by my colleague Pete Voorhees, and it was really a remarkable study because what we were able to demonstrate was that when you added daratumumab to RVD in the context of transplantation, you improved complete response rate and high quality response was met. But very, very importantly, you were able to demonstrate MRD negativity dramatically improved over time and particularly across consolidation and maintenance. And look at these progression-free survival curves. They're really quite superb. So this was really very, very encouraging, and the overall survival looks absolutely super as well. Now this was updated at ASH by my colleague Dr. Jonathan Kaufman, and the message here is that this MRD negativity improved across maintenance with both daratumumab and lenalidomide compared to lenalidomide alone, and that very, very importantly, the MRD negative rate continued to improve over time. And this is illustrated here in the context of the 12 months of maintenance. and at the same time here at the end of consolidation. So really a continuum of benefit from the four drug platform. So this then begs the question, if you've got these very exciting four drug platforms, what then does transplant add to this? And this, of course, is going to become now a very important new area of study. Now, to show you some of the data that's reflective of this, this is work from the University of Alabama group, the so-called master trial led by Dr. Luciano Costa. I'm going to show you some of the primary data presented at ASH approximately a year ago, and then this was updated at the meeting in December last year. But very quickly, when you put KRD DARA and use transplant at the same time, results are outstanding, the MRD negative rates are really quite impressive, and so this looks very good, and updates from the ASH meetings suggested this benefit is sustained. When you look interestingly at KRD DARA, but you don't necessarily go to transplant, and this is work led by my colleague Ola Landgren, and you keep transplant in reserve, it's very interesting because actually things look very similar in terms of MRD negativity. And we'll have to see what that means in terms of progression-free survival, but this suggests that transplant in the setting of a four-drug platform may also be something that can be kept in reserve. So to examine this question more, we are pursuing in follow-up to our determination trial, a so-called Determination 2 study. This has been developed now, and we hope to have this ready for evaluation and enrollment for our patients, possibly as early as 2022, depending on what we see from 2021 results from the existing determination trial. But suffice to say, the goal is to show if you're an MRD negative early, do you really need a transplant? Can you simply keep it in reserve? And the surrogate for that is if you're in a high quality response to initial treatment, do you need a transplant or you can keep it in reserve and avoid the toxicity and the potential issues later in the course of your disease? And obviously, looking at that will require an important prospective evaluation, and our hypothesis would be therefore to tailor treatment. Do you need more or less depending on what your MRD negative status is, and at the same time, is does maintenance require a particularly innovative approach, or can it be more cautious? So as we think about newly diagnosed treatment, we can summarize really the position as follows. Innovations including proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulators, monoclonal antibodies and so-called HDACs, which I'll come to in a minute, have produced significant improvements in progression-free and overall survival, and we do feel that quadruplet therapies are emerging as a new standard. There is now a next wave of immune therapies, which I'll touch on briefly in a moment, and baseline immune function is a key barrier to success, and again, we'll talk about this in more detail in a moment. But we do strongly feel that monoclonal antibodies, and in particular the next generation of antibodies, the so-called antibody-drug conjugates, the bispecific T-cell engagers, which we'll talk about in a moment, represent true new novel mechanisms. And then, of course, we have the excitement of the so-called cellular therapy or CAR-T approaches and vaccines that may supplant the need for some of our more traditional approaches to newly diagnosed upfront management of myeloma, including transplant in younger patients. Having said that, we must be very careful to recognize that there is a real role to targeting this stemness of disease, and in particular high risk, and therefore, in the context of cytotoxic therapy, it's important to note that there are exciting new drugs like melflufen, which we'll come to in a minute, that may have a particular role for this so-called stemness. And at the same time, there are other drugs, such as selinexor, venetoclax, and CELMoDs, which we'll talk all about in a moment, that may be particularly valuable in this setting. And I think what's so important is in the newly diagnosed setting, the refinement of prognostics and immune profiling and MRD will allow us to guide therapy in a much more tailored and selective way. So, in the next half of my presentation, I want to spend time on the definition of relapsed refractory myeloma and what it means. In the interest of time, I simply won't go through this in more detail, but just please know that once your disease has been in remission, achieved remission, stayed in remission, God willing, for many years, and then comes back, it needs to be addressed proactively and creatively. And when we look at relapses, there are a variety of characters. Sometimes they're very relatively indolent and not particularly aggressive, and we can adapt our treatment accordingly. And sometimes they can be really nasty, and we need to be very aggressive in how we bring together a combination of agents to help. So by that position, I want to show you some data to support why we think in those terms. From some years ago, we recognized that responses to treatment with each initial line typically, unfortunately, declined. And we tried to better understand why that may be. And on the right of this slide, what I'm trying to illustrate here is clonal diversity and how treatments can lead to clonal diversification and more aggressive clones emerging from the myeloma itself. The message really here is that in the context of clonal diversity and heterogeneity, throwing a big net around the disease and shutting it down is important, but particularly in the relapsed refractory setting, and that we need to be very careful because as disease becomes more and more refractory and more resistant, outcomes unfortunately become much more guarded. So in terms of treatment start for relapse, I've summarized them here. We should think about when we initiate treatment. Sometimes we can afford to watch a little bit, but I always think of relapse disease as guilty until proven innocent, so we have to be careful about that. But having said that, there are general principles guiding what we do and when that allow us to be able to bring new drugs to the space. And obviously participation in clinical trials can be very helpful in convenience, new approaches and so forth in helping our patients. But generally speaking, we pick new treatments based on prior therapies, as I mentioned, risk, frailty, toxicities, whether or not transplant's been used or could be used, and of course, above all, your preference and the goals of care, as well as the importance of logistics, and particularly during the COVID-19 pandemic, the convenience of oral therapy and infrequent visits to the clinic is self-evident. And now this gives you an idea of how many options we have. It's just a very good news, a big menu. This is another data analysis that shows you that if you look at lenalidomide-based therapies, we've got some great platforms that allow us to offer benefit from that. And if we look at proteasome-based in studies, similarly, substantial benefit from these approaches. And then on the block, of course, is pomalidomide, which has provided us with a really exciting new immunomodulatory approach to the relapsed refractory setting that helps. And in that regard, some pivotal work has been done. This is one example of our own work with, in partnership with our colleagues across the world, where we demonstrated that the three-drug platform, pomalidomide plus bortezomib, relatively practical and real-world type combination, is highly effective and helpful for patients. Now, a couple of important points about administration considerations for proteasome inhibitors. Just a few technical points to share with you, but I think these are worthwhile. One, bortezomib can be given subcutaneously. Sometimes if you have extramedullary disease or disease that's proving refractory, going back to the intravenous route, if it's tolerated, can be helpful. Side effects include peripheral neuropathy, but we can handle this very well. And then in terms of carfilzomib, for example, we also recognize that we have to be very careful about the pulmonary and cardiac issues, but generally speaking, this is very manageable. Neuropathy, fortunately, is not an issue, so that's very exciting. And then, of course, there's the excitement around exazomib, which is an all-oral approach, particularly helpful in COVID times, but at the same time, well-tolerated, although arguably not as potent as carfilzomib and bortezomib. Now, when you think about immunomodulatory drugs, I've shown here some of the things we should think about in terms of side effects to watch out for. The good news is, generally speaking, things are generally very manageable, but they have different side effect profiles. Lenalidomide can cause diarrhea. In contrast, pomalidomide typically does not, which is good news, obviously. Both of these drugs, however, can cause venous thromboembolism and fatigue and so forth. So these are things to be on the lookout for and particularly appropriate to take them on with a variety of side effect management strategies. Now, what about other drugs? Well, panobinostat is perhaps an underappreciated drug, and I especially want to acknowledge my colleague, Dr. Jacob Laubach, who's done some beautiful work with panobinostat and better understanding how we optimize its use. And Jacob presented some very nice work at the ASH meeting, which was actually published also in The Lancet last year, in which we were able to show that panobinostat combined with bortezomib subcutaneously performed really very well. This data is actually from the original papers published earlier, and this particular study led to the FDA approval of panobinostat. But suffice to say, the differences are clear, but tolerability was something of a challenge. Having said that, underappreciated is that panobinostat can have a dramatic role in the setting of specific resistance profiles, such as being refractory to an immunomodulatory drug and refractory to proteasome inhibitor. The use of panobinostat can be very helpful. Now, what about monoclonal antibody-based approaches? Well, I'm going to focus briefly on CD38 and SLAMF7. Suffice to say, daratumumab, which targets CD38, is dramatic. This is wonderful data showing the benefit to daratumumab. If you combine it with proteasome inhibition, it also is very beneficial, and these are very important outcomes. And then very exciting recent data leading to an FDA approval, in fact, was that combined with carfilzomib, which is particularly exciting. Now, similarly, if you combine a daratumumab with pomalidomide, the results are excellent. And we now had data at the ASH meeting that really showed that these results were impressive. And this data at ASH showed that basically the use of daratumumab with pomalidomide was remarkably active. The Apollo phase 3 study, which I've summarized here, and I think you heard of from earlier from Ken, really just confirmed this, which was great news. Now, in that same spirit, we've also been able to show that when you combine isatuximab, which is CD38 targeting as well, but qualitatively different to daratumumab, you see great results as well. So as we think about daratumumab, it may be that daratumumab's great up front, but when we need to think about CD38 again in relapse, isatuximab may be particularly important. And in that regard, there was a fabulous presentation from my colleague, Dr. Philippe Moreau, on the so-called ICAMA study, which was a combination of isatuximab plus carfilzomib, in which the combination clearly performed extremely well. Now, elotuzumab is an underappreciated antibody, but just suffice to say that the results with it can be very impressive, and when you combine it with pomalidomide, the results are even better. Now, what about general considerations for antibodies? Well, I just want to make a few points here. Daratumumab can be given subcutaneously as a game changer. It really does make a much easier administration of drug. Elotuzumab, very well tolerated, a gentle antibody, generally speaking, and very, very easy to administer. Isatuximab, less infusion reactions than Dara, and also, interestingly, quicker to give. However, not subcutaneous yet, so this is an important difference. Now, in the last few minutes, I want to close by focusing on selected novel targeted agents for relapsed refractory myeloma and move through these relatively quickly for you. Selinexor is a new kid on the block, a powerful drug, completely novel mechanism of action, basically targeting what's called XPO1. And the way to think about it, I think, is that there's a sort of rave going on at home, and the parents have left, and the kids are unfortunately getting out of line. And worse than that, they're using social media to invite more terrible friends to come and turn the place upside down. This really speaks to a mechanism of action which revolves around how the tumor uses its abnormal genetics to send messages to the cytosol so the cancer cell can grow more aggressively, and it also eliminates tumor suppressor proteins, i.e. the parents. What selinexor does is shut the rave down. It stops the mechanism of sending social media out, and it puts the parents back in the home, and so a rave quietens down very quickly. Very simplistic a metaphor, but actually quite accurate, because it does show exactly how selinexor works. Very novel mechanism action, but powerful, and the side effect profile is real. Having said that, having demonstrated its benefit as a single agent in the most difficult to treat disease, triple class refractory myeloma, we were able to combine it in the so-called Boston trial, which we published last year and presented updates at ASH, where we were able to show that if you combined it with weekly bortezomib and gave the drug weekly as opposed to twice weekly, it was much better tolerated. Moreover, we were able to target high-risk disease and reduce neuropathy. So some real excitement, and the FDA approved this platform in December of last year, and here with the data that support it. So selinexor can be combined with other drugs and is showing great promise. I mentioned venetoclax earlier, another very exciting oral agent, very well tolerated. Very interestingly, active if you have 11-14 translocation in your cancer. If not, use with extreme caution, if not, actually not at all. Because oddly enough, if you give it to patients who are not 11-14 positive, and I show that on the right of the slide, you can see actually it can do considerable harm. So fascinatingly, venetoclax, an oral pill you take up to 800 milligrams daily, generally well tolerated, although you've got to be very careful about infections. It can be incredibly helpful if you're 11-14 translocated in terms of your disease, but not otherwise. Now, I mentioned melflufen. This is, I think, very important to share with you. Melflufen is a novel drug peptide conjugate. In other words, it delivers its warhead of an alkylator payload directly to the cancer cell and leaves the normal tissues to one side. It really is a new mechanism of action, and preclinically has been very active. And we're very much hoping that this will provide significant benefit for patients going forward. To date, we've been able to demonstrate that we've got a response rate in about a third of patients, and very importantly, that this is durable. And at the same time, we can target what we call extramedullary disease, which is very important. And at the ASH meeting, there was fabulous data from my colleague, Dr. Enrique Osio, combining melflufen with other drugs that looks very promising. And as I mentioned at the beginning, hopefully we're going to be in a position to move forward with this as an approved drug in the next month or two. Now, what about immune therapy? Well, you heard very nicely about this from Ken, so I'm going to move through it very quickly, but just emphasize some key takeaways. CAR T therapy, so-called BiTEs, then monoclonal antibody drug conjugates, and finally CELMoDs. Now, antibody drug conjugates are fascinating. This is a way of delivering in an antibody-directed fashion a warhead to the tumor, not dissimilar in some ways to melflufen, but by virtue of the fact that it uses a monoclonal antibody platform, it enhances the immune response to that process and triggers what we call immunogenic cell death. Belantamab mafodotin is the primary example. This was the DREAM 1 study, and we confirmed in DREAM 2 that the results were very impressive. And this led, obviously, to the FDA approval of this drug last summer. However, keratopathy is a problem, and we need to figure out how best to use it. So combination strategies have become the way to go forward. In that regard, we're seeing really impressive results with early data so far, and we're doing our best to minimize the keratopathy. Now, when you combine this drug with bortezomib, the results are excellent, as I just showed, but when you combine them with pomalidomide, they're even better, and this is from Dr. Suzanne Trudell and her team, in which she combined belantamab mafodotin with pomalidomide, and whilst they did see keratopathy, at the lower doses it appeared to be less. What's really impressive is the response rates. These are really quite remarkable in the relapsed refractory setting. Now, what about BiTEs? Well, I've summarized them here. These are particularly exciting. Again, the takeaway, and I know Dr. Anderson spent time on this, so I'm not going to dwell on it other than to reemphasize Ken's points that BiTEs are really making a difference in multiple myeloma. Similarly, there are a variety of newer approaches with these BiTEs beyond BCMA that are very exciting, and particular examples are included here that illustrate how this can really potentially work well. Now, I must emphasize, these data are early, but the bispecific T-cell engaging mechanism allows us to deliver in an off-the-shelf way a strategy that doesn't require necessarily ex vivo manipulation of T-cells in the way that we have to do so with the CAR-T platforms. Having said that, these platforms are very exciting because we now also have newer targets beyond BCMA, and one example is GPRC5D. This actually beautiful work led by a wonderful colleague who's just joined us here at Dana-Farber from Memorial, Dr. Eric Smith, done beautiful work in this regard. And as a result of this, his discovery, we now have a new target that could be very, very exciting. Now, what about CAR-T therapy? Again, Ken covered this in detail. My takeaway is very much the same as his. Promising, exciting. Side effect profile is real, but really biologically a fabulous new concept. Now, not for everyone, and very much a selected modality, but the best data we have to date are really with the BB21 platform or IDA-cell, really showing durability of response and excellent overall response rates with manageable toxicity. And we think this is the particular study that will go forward to FDA approval. There is also beyond this a longer-acting Bluebird Bio platform called 21217, and this is looking very exciting as well. Now, finally, there are a number of other platforms that are being developed, and these are particularly promising, as mentioned above. Now, I want to close by focusing on the CELMoDs. The CELMoDs are something more than immunomodulatory drugs. They're quite distinct. They're cereblon E3 ligase inhibitors, a pill. You take them 3 weeks on and 1 week off, and in various combinations, they're particularly exciting. One excellent example, led by my colleague Dr. Sagalonial, is iberdomide combined with dexamethasone, and results here show remarkable response rates in triple-class refractory patients. And with this kind of benefit, we're very hopeful that this particular platform, so-called iberdomide, will become a new oral therapy of choice in the relapse setting. Now, beyond that, though, is real excitement around the combinations of this drug with other backbone agents. And my colleague Niels van der Donk presented our work at ASH as an oral session. And the real message here was that these were remarkably positive results with outstanding response rates. Now, beyond iberdomide, we have another new exciting cereblon E3 ligase modulator called, for now, CC92480, so 480 for short. And we were able to demonstrate excellent responses as monotherapy given 3 weeks on and 1 week off, just as an outpatient therapy in the clinic in triple-class refractory patients. So we're very excited by this and think this presents a real opportunity for a highly convenient, well-tolerated approach, and the combination strategies are really quite dramatic. Now, I realize that we're running against the clock here, so I'm going to finish up with these last few closing comments. But what I want to emphasize is the excitement around new treatments, the excitement about the management not only of the newly diagnosed patients, but also in the relapsed refractory setting, and how we have a plethora of options to offer our patients. And obviously, that cellular therapy, that including CAR-T, including bispecific T-cell engagers, is really a very exciting new direction. Now, I want to close with a patient story, building up over and above the wonderful story that you have of Jim Bond. But I also want to close with another story. And obviously, I show Deb's slides with her permission. Deb's a wonderful patient who was my privilege to meet in 2009. She presented with high-risk disease. Originally, in the community at that time, she was getting lenalidomide with Zometa, but we added bortezomib to improve the response. She did very well with the RVD and went to stem cell transplant. Now, she had lenalidomide maintenance afterwards because she really didn't want to get a proteasome inhibitor and wanted the freedom of just an oral approach. And if she was doing that now, we probably would recommend exazimib as a pill for her at that time. However, back then we didn't have that available to her, so we did the lenalidomide plus Zometa. Unfortunately, after about a year, her disease came back, and this, I think, reflects her high-risk features in her cancer, specifically the 17p deletion. So in that context, we then initiated salvage therapies, and she did very well for a couple of years, but then, unfortunately, the disease exploded and became very aggressive. We were very fortunate at that time to have her participate in our CD38 daratumumab monotherapy trial, as you can see, published in the New England Journal a few years later, and here led by my colleague Jacob. And what we were able to show was that this was a very active approach, and she's been on this drug now for over 7 years with an outstanding response and has a super quality of life, and the pictures of course reflect that. And as she said to me actually just the other day, best I've ever felt since prior to diagnosis, despite dealing with all the challenges of the COVID pandemic. So with that in mind, I want to thank you for your kind attention and really acknowledge all of our partners and the extraordinary teamwork that goes in to making what you just heard possible. And this obviously isn't just here at Dana-Farber, this is across the country and indeed across the world. But it's truly an honor to be part of such an extraordinary effort. And above all, I'm so eternally grateful to you, our patients and families, for giving us the privilege of being able to participate in your care. And at that point, I think I'll close and be available for questions. Thank you so much.